Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. This is Rob here at Smirking Gun Reviews, back with more old S.H.I.E.L.D. new reviews. Yeah, we took a bit of a break to work on some other projects, including the Agents S.H.I.E.L.D. Season 1 retrospective that we did on these reviews. And the reason you're getting one of these right now is because I had to postpone my Agent Carter reviews this week to next week. We were going to be doing episodes 3 and 4. But my work schedule changed, and so we had to push back the reviews for those until next week, which means I got to get a jump early on this return of this show, which we will be continuing in a weekly basis from here on out, unless I need to take another break for other reasons, because we are doing a lot on the channel. But it's good to be back talking about this, because where we left off, I was, I knew this one was going to be a special one for a lot of people. Surprisingly, D from over at D's Reviews actually doesn't like this one, and one of these days we're going to actually hear about why he doesn't. And I tried to watch it with an eye for why he doesn't, and there might be some clues in here to maybe why he doesn't like it. But we're talking about Season 3, Episode 13. It's called Parting Shot. This is the final episode, kind of Bobbi and Hunter. Now, I can't remember if Bobbi ever comes back, but I do believe Nick Blood does. But I'm not 100% if I'm remembering that correctly. I remember him Nick Blood coming back in some capacity to help Coulson. I just don't know if that's now or if that was in the past already. But this is the Spies Goodbye. This is their last hurrah. And I can kind of see why some people might not like it. We've got a kind of a jumping back and forth time story, but there is no changing the ending to this. And how emotional it was. And not just them in the bar. Full spoilers, by the way, if you haven't seen this. It was everything kind of leading up to it, the last 5 or 6 minutes of this episode. Because throughout this episode, back and forth, you know, as Hunter brings up his problems with moving, you know, where they're at in their relationship, where they are with S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, questions are coming up. Hunter part of that group in Season 2 with Lucy Lawless's character, they had their own things going on. He was part of a different group. He wasn't part of S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, and Bobbi, she was part of the real S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, that turned out to have, you know, Edward James Olmos, and Mac was a part of that, and, you know, none of them were the beginning members of our S.H.I.E.L.D. group. They kind of got pulled in after everything else, you know, fell apart. Hunter's group dead because of Creel, the absorbing man. And, you know, the rest of real S.H.I.E.L.D. kind of, well, you know, some of them, I think, some of them might have survived, but you have whoever's left from that, you know, kind of absorbed into Coulson's team. And so throughout all these adventures and things that have happened, Bobbi and Hunter almost dying, Ward almost killing Bobbi, you know, like, working with Creel, things that are bothering Hunter about these things and the patterns that he's seeing, you know, it brings up early, you know, and their vacations that they never take, and, you know, they're trying to rebuild their relationship, but S.H.I.E.L.D., what's going on with S.H.I.E.L.D. right now, still working in the shadows, still basically supposedly non-existent, you know, them trying to find a place for themselves, and this episode is a little bit convenient in that way of saying, well, this is their out. Now, why did they leave? You know, that was kind of part of my problem with this. Because they were... It goes to what we'll talk about in our Season 3 retrospective, I believe, in February. But I'm going to bring it up here, because it'll be a few months before we get to that. And that was that they had this pilot, right? That it was filmed. And I would love to get my hands on it. You know, I want to see what they had in the can. But they were getting their own spinoff. And like a lot of things that happen sometimes on shows, it was a storyline that got dropped. It was a show that was never picked up. And so it's a shame that they weren't able to reabsorb them onto our show, onto the core group of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. again. But was it also partially due to budgets? But see, you know, and was the show really not picked up because the strength of the original show wasn't strong enough to support a spinoff? Or maybe it was a bunch of these reasons all put together. I'd really like to know some of these answers. They're not important questions to the, you know, human existence, but it's part of that conversation, some of the conversations that we have about drop storylines and things like that. And it's just whether you didn't like Bobbi or Hunter, and I know some people don't, you know, I personally miss them greatly. I personally was disappointed that they never came back in the final season in some capacity or in the finale. Especially any of them. I mean, I feel like Nick Blood at least should have been able to show up. Maybe Adrian Palicki, I don't know. But this is their goodbye. And it's easier to talk about the things surrounding it episode because it's not an amazing episode. You know, it's them captured in Moscow. You've got three dead government agents, or Russian, you know, highly decorated Russians. And them having to explain, you know, what they did, what their role is, admit your shield, that kind of thing. And we get interspersed back and forth of what happened then and what's happening now. And how they got to the point where they're captured and where's the rest of shield. And we get this guy here, this inhuman assassin, that plays a tiny role in this. But that tiny role was actually really cool. And the visual effects team that did an excellent job on this shadow assassin. So basically, they go in to track Malick's convoy. You know, Hunter and Bobbi are out there. This is where the whole conversation comes up of what they're really doing with S.H.I.E.L.D. You know, why have never taken a real regular vacation? That was pretty funny. Of course, S.H.I.E.L.D. is always great with the banter. The writing between these characters is always so great. You know, bringing up the different vacations and getting to Florence and him going, that wasn't me, love. Like, you know, and awkward, oh yeah, that's right, she, you know, she's been with other people since me, and all that stuff. But in the meantime, they get captured, and they have to fight their way out. We get a pretty decent action sequence here, where we see those magnetic batons come flying back out at her. That's always really great. The visual effects in this episode, like I said, were really good. The action that when it was here was really good. The stuff between them and the fighting the shadow monster was really, really good. But, you know, they take out these guys, they get back to the ship, and they tell everybody what's going on. You can't take out Malick. You know, they need somebody who speaks Russian. Bobby's the only one, conveniently, you know, that speaks Russian. So they have two teams going, and it's Hunter and May, again, they pair them up quite a lot this season. And you got Daisy, Bobbi, and Mac on the other team. And, you know, we get these a couple of great moments between Hunter and May. Them still talking about what it means to be S.H.I.E.L.D. You know, their whole we're not friends thing. And him saying, I would have taken a bullet for any of you. You know, not because of the logo, you know, not because of S.H.I.E.L.D., not because of our logo, but because of you. And then she gets, you know, brings up the whole, you know, going to kill Andrew thing and that this isn't us. You know, that's not how we do things. And it's just that kind of core ideals where he apologizes to her for what he did, but he's not going to apologize for being who he is and how he is and what his core values mean. We have a really, and then you got like, you know, there's a moment here with Malick I wanted to bring up where he's talking about what he's trying to do and he compares Inhumans to how if they hadn't put Native Americans on reservations, Native Americans would have been completely wiped out. And that what they're trying to do with Inhumans is the same thing. And it's to their benefit and to humanity's benefit and we have to side with them. It is like, Powers Boothe, and I've said this before, is so great, but the stuff he's saying is so awful. It is so horrid trying to compare these things. But we find out that there's a setup happening. The Prime Minister had a personal attaché that was killed when he went there, because the Prime Minister does not support this inhuman thing. And what we find out is that Malick is trying to set up a coup, and that the when he finds out, you know, like the general, right, is an Inhuman himself. The guy who killed the attaché is a general. He's a general in the Russian army who also happens to be an Inhuman. This Malick sees as his chance that bring the prime minister's coming there. Let this Inhuman out. He'll kill the prime minister for us, getting rid of any opposition to the Inhuman reservation that they want to make. And he won't look like he had anything to do with it. What we find out, though, is that the general isn't the assassin. He can't control a version of himself, which is basically dark force made into a shadow. Now, that is kind of ripping off an X-Files called Soft Light that had Tony Shalhoub, who had a shadow that would suck you into a, basically, you would be reduced to antimatter in the shadow. Except it was just a shadow. It didn't go running around like this one. So they improved on it a little bit. But in order to stop the shadow, you have to stop the man. It works independently from him. And we don't even really get to know for sure if the general can control it or is in knowledge of it. But we have this really great fight scene with them trying to fight this thing. It coming from the floor and through the walls and stuff. And it's really great. And Hunter is in a bad position, and Bobbi kills the general, killing the assassin, and we have to deal with the consequences of that. And they're intercut with the interrogation of this, guy that's from Interpol, who is also a really great character actor, and where he's from is slipping my mind. He's been in a few things that I liked. Blame has to be laid somewhere, even though they saved the prime minister's life. Even William Sadler's president of the United States brought in to step in, which was a little bit weird. Like, really? Is it that big of an... It just is weird seeing the president just standing there in this about this mission. But I guess it's important enough, and hey, William Sadler, you can get him. Why not? But basically, they have to take the fall. Hunter and Bobbi have to take the fall. Otherwise, S.H.I.E.L.D. gets blamed for this. And that would probably mean the ultimate demise of S.H.I.E.L.D. if they're blamed for these three deaths that happened on Russian soil to Russian government officials. Even though they saved the prime minister's life, somebody has to take the fall for it. But if they don't admit that they're S.H.I.E.L.D. and just get disavowed, then, you know, problem solved. But what's great here is Coulson going in, cutting the sound, which should have led those guys to just come barging right in, to be honest. If they can't hear what's going on, why don't they just charge in there? Say, hey, we can't hear what's going on. But whatever, then Coulson wouldn't get to give them the secret plan to help them escape with an EMP, and everybody's ready to just get them out of there and give them new identities and everything. But they choose to stay. They choose to stay and take the fall themselves. And Coulson, you know, begrudgingly accepts this. And in front of the prime minister and the president, he's like, thank you, you know, and it's what you have to read between the lines, where he's thanking them for everything they've done while making them not sound like they are affiliated to any government agency whatsoever. And he can't put it out there. They never get to be fully acknowledged for what they did, but Coulson tries to word it in a way that makes it sound like, you know, hey, thanks, but, you know, and even convinces the prime minister, hey, they should be free to go then, right? They don't work for any agency. Nobody takes responsibility for it, and they get let go. They just can never be S.H.I.E.L.D. agents again. And the scene when Coulson comes into the Zephyr and tells everybody is another great scene, because they're all sitting there waiting to make their move to rescue Hunter and Bobbi. And they never get the signal, and Coulson's got to tell them what went down. And especially Mac, this really hurts. And it also, surprisingly, May is kind of taken aback by this too, because this is Hunter kind of acknowledging what May was talking about. You know, we're not gonna just, I'm not some just rash fuck up. I understand what's at stake. I understand what I need to do. I do take this seriously. Them allowing themselves to be, you know, laid out, you know, hung out to dry. And so I'm sure that that affects May. But they're a family. We talk about this a lot. That our group is a family. And I'm, even if you don't like Hunter and Bobbi, they're a part of, they've been a part of this family since season two. So a season and a half with these characters. We didn't even get that much with Trip, okay? Everybody really taught, we talk about Trip a lot, but he was in it for only a few, maybe the last bit of season one and the first bit of season two. Then he's gone. In fact, some people even got him confused with Mac. But Hunter and Bobbi were really key here, and I thought Hunter always gave a lot of comic relief. I liked his very gung-ho at killing willingness to kill, if it was asked or not asked of him. Adrian Palicki, here Mockingbird, we don't get a lot of Marvel ties literally to the comics or the overall universe too often, but Adrian Palicki, she's gorgeous and she's a great actress, and she brought a lot to this character that doesn't get a lot to do even in the MCU now. I really dug it. I really, really dug those guys. And so they get their spies goodbye. They go, they're in a bar, and all of a sudden shots are being delivered to them, and there's Gemma, and she can't say anything, and they realize, that's when Bobbi realizes what's happening, and it's that last acknowledgement, that quiet nod. Fitz is there, Mac is there, May, Daisy, Coulson, all in different parts of the bar as they keep delivering them shots to say goodbye. And just for anybody who's wondering by the thumbnail that I did this, don't worry, I'm not drinking. This is Flying Cauldron's butterscotch beer. It's butterscotch soda. Tastes like magic. So they get the spies goodbye. Everybody has tears, and you know, it's, there was a moment here, and I'm gonna bring this up when we talk about this in February, because I think this kind of brings this show, this episode back. I'm gonna try to get D back on board with this one, because it's Adrian Palicki's Bobbi who tells Coulson, "We took an oath." You know, he's like, we can get you out of here. We, doesn't matter. We'll be fine. You know, we'll get you out. But she's the one who says, we took the oath to be the shield. And that's what we're doing right now. And that's a powerful moment, because that is a huge thing to say. This up all the time, about, especially nowadays. To be the shield. And what they're doing here is a self-sacrifice, and even though it gives them a chance to start their lives over, it's a huge sacrifice, because these are two, you know, she's a basically a superhero, and he's a, you know, a highly professional, at times, mercenary who's highly skilled. So how do these people, you know, even, you know, go back to regular lives? And so this is, you know, even though nothing came of it, like a lot of things, like the Inhuman storyline in itself, it's still a powerful emotional kick to lose a member of the family. And now we lost not just one, but two. And the only good thing about it is they're not dead. Because a lot of characters just get killed, like Trip. You know, like, you know, members of Real S.H.I.E.L.D., you know, a lot of people just come and go. You know, like Hunter's, you know, leader before, Lucy Lawless, she's killed in like the first episode she's in. So a lot of people don't get out of here alive. And so, but that was because they were trying to make a pilot, and but it doesn't, to me it doesn't take away from the emotional goodbye that we have here. And I'm trying to think of anything else to say. Like I said, the visual effects were fantastic. I mean, we get a stinger with Malick and his daughter and them just talking about Ward and how S.H.I.E.L.D. doesn't know anything about it yet. But that felt like it shouldn't even be here. The ending should have just been this and not try to tack anything on that didn't matter. So I have a little bit of an issue with, like, that kind of takes me out of the episode. Like, it should have just been the beginning of a new episode or at the end of a different episode. But other than that, I do really dig this emotional episode. And next week we'll be talking about Watch Dogs. We're starting a whole, like, this is kind of that hole in the middle, like, how sometimes after a huge arc in a comic book, there'll just be a single issue of something. It usually doesn't mean anything, but this one does. Before we start into the end bit, we've got like 9 episodes left. 8 episodes left where we're going to deal with Ward and Hive and everything like that. So that's it. That's this episode. Goodbye, Hunter and Bobbi. You know, we hardly knew ye. And so, if you like this review, please hit the like button, comment, share, subscribe, hit the bell for all notifications. We will be back next week. Hopefully, all schedules stay the same for Agent Carter. Season 1, Episodes 3 and 4, we'll be back with Corey Shoemaker talking about Agent Carter. Of course, we've got Boba Fett reviews, The Mandalorian on Fridays. His Dark Materials, Season 2, we just started doing reviews for that Mondays. And we've got other stuff going on all the time. Over on Twitch at Smirking Gun Plays, we're currently playing Miles Morales, Spider-Man. We're going to be jumping into Assassin's Creed Valhalla on Twitch. But we also have my other YouTube channel, Smirking Gun Plays, if you want to subscribe over there, where we also play games on my day off. It's all about, like, having to switch information around. But also, if you've made it this far, I have been telling people about the laptop, the gaming laptop, that I'm going to be getting the way more powerful laptop. Most people say that there's nothing wrong with the camera here, or they'll say there's something wrong with the audio. But that's mostly, I think, because I don't have my microphone, like, right up to my face. But the problem with my laptop is that it's not powerful enough to go 1080p. My editing software is not powerful enough. My laptop is not powerful enough to handle the editing software that I use. And so everything has a lot of kind of crackles and weird jumps where my voice will be cut out and stuff like that. So we're trying to get a new laptop here. And if you feel like you want to donate to the channel, you can go to my PayPal at paypal.me/smirkingunreviews. Any donation would be, you know, helpful, appreciated, all those things. I'm not good at doing this part of anything, and it's not expected, but if you feel like donating to the channel, it is much appreciated. And so, this is it. We will see you next week for Watch Dogs. Have a great night, and thanks for watching. Bye. Be the shield.